On the way, I was crowned a king. Felt the wind underneath my wings. I've been high and I've been low. Played the fool in the star of the show. Gone along for a wild ride. And I can say, looking in your eyes, that it all would have been a waste. But I found you on the way. I found cynicism. If the one thing that I can say, I found you.
Challenge. All you gotta do is leave it better than you found it. It's gonna get difficult to stand, but hold your balance. I just say whatever, cause there is no way you're round it. Everyone falls down sometimes, but you just gotta know it'll all be fine. It's okay. It's okay. And nothing works, you feel surrounded. Gotta give your feet some gravity to get you grounded. Keep good things inside your ears, just like the waves and sound it. And just say whatever, cause there is no way you're grounded. Everyone falls down sometimes, but you just gotta know it'll all be fine. It's okay. It's okay. Sunshine on my Sunday best. Hey, feeling good, like I should. When in Durga, walk around the neighborhood. Feeling blessed, never stressed. Got that sunshine on my Sunday best.
How lucky. Something I cannot forget. Your word is gospel and I want you. Moving at the speed of light, two wrongs could still make a right if you believe it, and I want you. How lucky am I, how lucky am I, yeah, to love somebody, to love somebody.
Sometimes I wish you would've stayed in my dreams. Cause now that you're real, now I could lose ya. Nothing lasts forever, ain't as bad as it seems. Cause my favorite thing to do is to do nothing with you.
How lucky am I, how lucky am I, yeah, to love somebody, to love somebody. How lucky am I, how lucky am I, yeah, to love somebody, to love somebody. Like
joyride. She likes to roll here in my ashes anyway. Played from the bedside, still about starlight. There was my heart, the drums that start off night and day. The same kind of music haunts her bedroom. I'm almost me again, she's almost you. And I wouldn't know where to start. Sweet music playing in the dark. Be still my foolish heart, don't ruin this song. Do I owe each kiss to lip and cheek as soft as chicken sing? Let's get lost and let the good times roll. Let smoke rings from this paper doll blow sweet and thick till every thought of it don't mean a thing. I got some color back, she thinks so too. I laugh like me again, she laughs like you. I wouldn't know where to start. Sweet music playing in the dark. It's still my foolish heart. Don't ruin this on me.
Has had a great commitment to bringing in young researchers, and we see that at every conference. Many top scholars presented their first papers at a Hicks conference. Now, I have to say, I'm not a top scholar, but even for me personally, my very first professional presentation was at a Hicks conference some decades ago.
But I don't know of another conference that approaches the scope and the breadth, as well as the solid academics, as well as Hicks. And something I think those of us who were involved in it at the beginning are very proud of, that it's retained that kind of academic substance over a broad area over all these years. And I hope 50 years from now, there will be something equally unexpected on my part that the conference will evolve towards.
Tung Bui, as co-chair of the conference, took it seriously. He has done an amazing job of strengthening the conference, adding the ways that we communicate, adding the value of the interaction that comes from it.
So 50 years after, what we would like to do now is to bring the industry back, because with the new era of new software and hardware, the Internet of Things, the industrial Internet of Things and everything, I think it is also a good opportunity for us now to bring back the industry. And we are so fortunate to have IBM that has recognized us as a conference of choice.
Hicks has had a great commitment to bringing in young researchers, and we see that at every conference. Many top scholars presented their first papers at a Hicks conference. Now, I have to say, I'm not a top scholar, but even for me personally, my very first professional presentation was at a Hicks conference some decades ago.
But I don't know of another conference that approaches the scope and the breadth, as well as the solid academics, as well as Hicks. And something I think those of us who were involved in it at the beginning are very proud of, that it's retained that kind of academic substance over a broad area over all these years. And I hope 50 years from now, there will be something equally unexpected on my part that the conference will evolve towards.
Tung Bui, as co-chair of the conference, took it seriously. He has done an amazing job of strengthening the conference, adding the ways that we communicate, adding the value of the interaction that comes from it.
So 50 years after, what we would like to do now is to bring the industry back, because with the new era of new software and hardware, the Internet of Things, the industrial Internet of Things and everything, I think it is also a good opportunity for us now to bring back the industry. And we are so fortunate to have IBM that has recognized us as a conference of choice.
Hicks has had a great commitment to bringing in young researchers, and we see that at every conference. Many top scholars presented their first papers at a Hicks conference. Now, I have to say, I'm not a top scholar, but even for me personally, my very first professional presentation was at a Hicks conference some decades ago.
But I don't know of another conference that approaches the scope and the breadth, as well as the solid academics, as well as Hicks. And something I think those of us who were involved in it at the beginning are very proud of, that it's retained that kind of academic substance over a broad area over all these years. And I hope 50 years from now, there will be something equally unexpected on my part that the conference will evolve towards.
Tung Bui, as co-chair of the conference, took it seriously. He has done an amazing job of strengthening the conference, adding the ways that we communicate, adding the value of the interaction that comes from it.
So 50 years after, what we would like to do now is to bring the industry back, because with the new era of new software and hardware, the Internet of Things, the industrial Internet of Things and everything, I think it is also a good opportunity for us now to bring back the industry. And we are so fortunate to have IBM that has recognized us as a conference of choice.
Has had a great commitment to bringing in young researchers, and we see that at every conference. Many top scholars presented their first papers at a Hicks conference. Now, I have to say, I'm not a top scholar, but even for me personally, my very first professional presentation was at a Hicks conference some decades ago.
But I don't know of another conference that approaches the scope and the breadth, as well as the solid academics, as well as Hicks. And something I think those of us who were involved in it at the beginning are very proud of, that it's retained that kind of academic substance over a broad area over all these years. And I hope 50 years from now, there will be something equally unexpected on my part that the conference will evolve towards.
Tung Bui, as co-chair of the conference, took it seriously. He has done an amazing job of strengthening the conference, adding the ways that we communicate, adding the value of the interaction that comes from it.
So 50 years after, what we would like to do now is to bring the industry back, because with the new era of new software and hardware, the Internet of Things, the industrial Internet of Things and everything, I think it is also a good opportunity for us now to bring back the industry. And we are so fortunate to have IBM that has recognized us as a conference of choice.
Thank you. Pyxis had a great commitment to bringing in young researchers, and we see that at every conference. Many top scholars presented their first papers at a Hicks conference. Now, I have to say, I'm not a top scholar, but even for me personally, my very first professional presentation was at a Hicks conference some decades ago.
But I don't know of another conference that approaches the scope and the breadth, as well as the solid academics, as well as Hicks. And something I think those of us who were involved in it at the beginning are very proud of, that it's retained that kind of academic substance over a broad area over all these years. And I hope 50 years from now, there will be something equally unexpected on my part that the conference will evolve towards.
Tung Bui, as co-chair of the conference, took it seriously. He has done an amazing job of strengthening the conference, adding the ways that we communicate, adding the value of the interaction that comes from it.
So 50 years after, what we would like to do now is to bring the industry back, because with the new era of new software and hardware, the Internet of Things, the industrial Internet of Things and everything, I think it is also a good opportunity for us now to bring back the industry. And we are so fortunate to have IBM that has recognized us as a conference of choice.
Pyxis had a great commitment to bringing in young researchers, and we see that at every conference. Many top scholars presented their first papers at a Hicks conference. Now, I have to say, I'm not a top scholar, but even for me personally, my very first professional presentation was at a Hicks conference some decades ago.
But I don't know of another conference that approaches the scope and the breadth, as well as the solid academics, as well as Hicks. And something I think those of us who were involved in it at the beginning are very proud of, that it's retained that kind of academic substance over a broad area over all these years. And I hope 50 years from now, there will be something equally unexpected on my part that the conference will evolve towards.
Tung Bui, as co-chair of the conference, took it seriously. He has done an amazing job of strengthening the conference, adding the ways that we communicate, adding the value of the interaction that comes from it.
So 50 years after, what we would like to do now is to bring the industry back, because with the new era of new software and hardware, the Internet of Things, the industrial Internet of Things and everything, I think it is also a good opportunity for us now to bring back the industry. And we are so fortunate to have IBM that has recognized us as a conference of choice.
Has had a great commitment to bringing in young researchers, and we see that at every conference. Many top scholars presented their first papers at a Hicks conference. Now, I have to say, I'm not a top scholar, but even for me personally, my very first professional presentation was at a Hicks conference some decades ago.
But I don't know of another conference that approaches the scope and the breadth, as well as the solid academics, as well as Hicks. And on something I think those of us who were involved in it at the beginning are very proud of, that it's retained that kind of academic substance over a broad area over all these years. And I hope 50 years from now, there will be something equally unexpected on my part that the conference will evolve towards.
Tung Bui, as co-chair of the conference, took it seriously. He has done an amazing job of strengthening the conference, adding the ways that we communicate, adding the value of the interaction that comes from it.
So 50 years after, what we would like to do now is to bring the industry back, because with the new era of new software and hardware, the Internet of Things, the industrial Internet of Things and everything, I think it is also a good opportunity for us now to bring back the industry. And we are so fortunate to have IBM that has recognized us as a conference of choice.
Nix has had a great commitment to bringing in young researchers, and we see that at every conference. Many top scholars presented their first papers at a Hicks conference. Now, I have to say, I'm not a top scholar, but even for me personally, my very first professional presentation was at a Hicks conference some decades ago.
But I don't know of another conference that approaches the scope and the breadth, as well as the solid academics, as well as Hicks. And on something I think those of us who were involved in it at the beginning are very proud of, that it's retained that kind of academic substance over a broad area over all these years. And I hope 50 years from now, there will be something equally unexpected on my part that the conference will evolve towards.
Tung Bui, as co-chair of the conference, took it seriously. He has done an amazing job of strengthening the conference, adding the ways that we communicate, adding the value of the interaction that comes from it.
So 50 years after, what we would like to do now is to bring the industry back, because with the new era of new software and hardware, the Internet of Things, the industrial Internet of Things and everything, I think it is also a good opportunity for us now to bring back the industry. And we are so fortunate to have IBM that has recognized us as a conference of choice.
Has had a great commitment to bringing in young researchers, and we see that at every conference. Many top scholars presented their first papers at a Hicks conference. Now, I have to say, I'm not a top scholar, but even for me personally, my very first professional presentation was at a Hicks conference some decades ago.
But I don't know of another conference that approaches the scope and the breadth, as well as the solid academics, as well as Hicks. And on something I think those of us who were involved in it at the beginning are very proud of, that it's retained that kind of academic substance over a broad area over all these years. And I hope 50 years from now, there will be something equally unexpected on my part that the conference will evolve towards.
Tung Bui, as co-chair of the conference, took it seriously. He has done an amazing job of strengthening the conference, adding the ways that we communicate, adding the value of the interaction that comes from it.
So 50 years after, what we would like to do now is to bring the industry back, because with the new era of new software and hardware, the Internet of Things, the industrial Internet of Things and everything, I think it is also a good opportunity for us now to bring back the industry. And we are so fortunate to have IBM that has recognized us as a conference of choice.
Has had a great commitment to bringing in young researchers, and we see that at every conference. Many top scholars presented their first papers at a Hicks conference. Now, I have to say, I'm not a top scholar, but even for me personally, my very first professional presentation was at a Hicks conference some decades ago.
But I don't know of another conference that approaches the scope and the breadth, as well as the solid academics, as well as Hicks. And something I think those of us who were involved in it at the beginning are very proud of, that it's retained that kind of academic substance over a broad area over all these years. And I hope 50 years from now, there will be something equally unexpected on my part that the conference will evolve towards.
Aloha. A little bit louder, please. Aloha. Did you have a good lunch? Did you get fed well? Yeah, my staff said that in order to make the people happy, first thing first, good food. So we will try hard to get you the good food for the next 2 days or so. So since you said already aloha, I don't know many of you knows the meaning of it, but aloha basically means three things. One is hello. Aloha also means goodbye, and aloha also means love. So if you see somebody that you're interested in, just say aloha with a beautiful Hawaii smile, then you will be building a lifelong good relationship. But then for today, I would like to add another dimension to the word aloha, is that is to welcome you to the 53rd International Conference in System Sciences. So aloha. But then the most important message that I would like to share with you today is that thanks to the work for every one of you, the conference is getting better and better. And I know that we don't have much time, but I would like to share with you two metrics that is actually quite interesting. One is that since we put the proceedings of the conference on open space, just for the last 3 years of proceedings, and as of 2 days ago, I would like to report to you that we got 1,100,000 paper downloads on the conference proceedings. So congratulations to you all. And we also put a mirror copy of the site on the AIS website, which is a site restricted to each members only. On that site, we also got 80,000 plus paper download for the Higgs proceedings just for the last 3 years. And this is no wonder why other metrics have shown that Higgs is now the number one conference in the field in terms of citation. And Microsoft Data Analytics just released another statistics that is actually quite pleasing for us, is that they are tracking 4,352 conferences in all disciplines for the last 42 years, and then we are ranked 47 in that data analytics research as well. So thank you again for doing such a beautiful job in for this conference. So it's a pleasure for me, and I'm very thankful to have two bosses of mine at coming at Higgs. One is President David Lasner of the University of Hawaii system. He is currently busy with the state legislature, but he will be coming here as soon as he possibly can. And the second person that I'm very thankful about is my second boss, my dean of the Shadow College Business, Dean Vance Rowley. And I would like to welcome Vance to say a few welcoming words to the audience. Vance.
Thank you, Tung. It's welcome. It's always great to be here. And aloha. Okay, you're trained well, very well. Thank you very much. So let me welcome you to the 53rd annual Hawaii International Conference on System Sciences. And this is something I really enjoy at the beginning of each year, no exception, beginning of 2020 with our annual Higgs Conference. So as mentioned, 53rd year, this is the longest standing conference in the MIS computer science, system science fields currently in the world. And I have another duty now at the beginning each year, because in addition to the Higgs Conference, which I've been fortunate enough to welcome for the last 16 years as dean, I welcomed our new Hawaii Accounting Research Conference, or HARC. So we had HARC 3, we had that on the Big Island, and Higgs 53. So it was Big Island last week, Maui this week. The conference has really truly grown into a global conference, well over 1,000 participants, and more than half from outside the U.S. And spread all over the rest of the world. And as you know, conference is not just known for the quality of the papers, but for the professional interactions and the ideas that are spawned here at the conference. So the Higgs Conference is always a big event for the Schuyler College of Business each year. But let me just report a couple of things. And one thing I mentioned last year, but I'd like to mention again, is that, you know, one of our supporters, Jay Schuyler, has been generous, to say the least, for the college. So far, he's given $228 million to the college. And one of his gifts is something that might be interest to this group, and that is Jay Schuyler purchased the large Microsoft Advanta campus in Bellevue, Washington, and donated an interest in the land underlying the complex to the Schuyler College of Business. So we own the land under the big computing area for Microsoft. Another noteworthy thing that's happened to the college this academic year is our School of Travel Industry Management, which separated from the college in 1992, has rejoined us, and we're very excited about that, and we hope to reestablish it as one of the top five hospitality and tourism programs in the United States. And we're very excited about the prospects of doing that, and information systems, of course, is a big part of their job these days. So on behalf of the Schuyler College of Business, I would also like to thank the chair of this conference, Professor Tung Bui, for making this such a remarkable conference. Let's all give Tung Bui a round of applause. He also leads our very successful executive MBA program in Vietnam, where we've been there 18 years in Hanoi and 12 years in Ho Chi Minh City. It's just been a hugely successful program for us. So again, I'm fortunate this is my 16th time I've welcomed the Higgs Conference, and again, I would like to welcome you to Higgs 2020, Higgs 53. Thank you very much.
All right, let me just ask a show of hand. How many of you in the audience are here for the first time? Wow, look at this. This is what I'd like to see. Statistically, actually, it's 52% attendees of this year are the first time newcomer to the conference. And this is, to me, a very important indicator, metric, because we would like to see and nurture the conference. To me, this is a place where science speaks, and then this is exactly what is happening in the 18 rooms that we have here in the hallway and also in the beautiful beaches of that resort. So again, thank you so much for your participation to make this conference a very, very good one. For the 48% of the people who have been here, I would like to remind you that this year we have a little bit of different setup than the earlier years. This year we have three keynotes, and therefore the third one is on Friday after lunch, which used to be the award ceremony session, and therefore for the authors that have been nominated to receive the best papers of the year, the ceremony is going to be held at the Luau on Friday evening. So if you have been nominated, make sure that you show up at the Luau for the ceremony. So with no further ado, let me introduce you to the introducer of the keynote today, which is Dr. Bob Sutter, IBM Vice President of the Research Center in New York. When I look at his resume, it's just outstanding. The guy actually is the ideal person that every parent would like to be proud of. He graduated as a valedictorian in a high school. He went to Harvard for his bachelor in mathematics. Then he went to Princeton for his master and PhD in mathematics.
Then he became an IBMer since 1988, and from now as an intern, as a programmer, and now he's the vice president in charge of the quantum ecosystem for the research unit. So with no further ado, Bob, would you please come on stage and welcome Ito for us.
To be clear, I'm one of the executives in the quantum program. In a moment, I will be introducing our keynote speaker, but I'd like to start with a little context on quantum. Last year, we had a small workshop in quantum, which was very well received. Yesterday, we had a larger workshop on quantum computing, which was also, I believe, very well received from the feedback. And I think for some people, while you've been hearing about quantum computing more and more, you kind of get the idea that it's this new thing. Well, just about 50 years ago, the phrase quantum information theory was coined. In fact, by an IBM fellow, Charles Bennett, in February of 1970. And from there, of course, there was a lot of theoretical work. Nobody had quantum computers. And it's really only been since 2016 that quantum computers have been available on the web. And for free, I might add, which of course is extremely great for education. So as we start the 2020s, right, and you will see the phrase, the 2020s are the decade of quantum computing, and I'm sure you'll hear that about blockchain and IoT and everything else too. Let's see where we're starting, right? So it is not the case that only a few people do quantum computing. Certainly regarding research and the number of people who are teaching quantum computing, that's increasing quite a bit. In fact, in our program, the IBM Q Experience, we've had 200,000 people register and use the quantum systems. So if anyone tells you, oh, there are about 100 people doing quantum computing, they're off by several orders of magnitude. Have they done much with this? So have they run apps, the quantum equivalent at this point, which we call circuits? They have run over 60 billion, with a B, circuits on these quantum computers. So as much as we all need to be doing more quantum, and our keynote speaker will talk much more about that, this is well underway, and there are tremendous resources available to you. So as you hear what Professor Ito will be saying, as well as in the Birds of a Feather session, so immediately after the keynote, Professor Ito and I will stay here, and we will answer any questions whatsoever about quantum computing, about teaching, about hardware, and so forth. So we'd very much like to have a great quantum program sessions today, but I'm also thinking about the future. I want quantum to be a big part of HICS in the future, right? So if it's going to be the most important technology for the decade, let's kick it off here in Hawaii. All right. So our keynote speaker, Kohai Ito, Ito-san, is a professor at Keio University in Tokyo and in Yokohama. He's the dean of the Faculty of Science and Technology, as well as the Graduate School of Science and Technology. Basically, if it's science and technology at Keio, it is Professor Ito. He was an undergraduate at Keio University. He received his master's and his PhD from the University of California at Berkeley. He just couldn't stay away, I guess. You came back to Keio in 1995 and became a professor in 2007. He has received many prizes through his career. And in fact, he is one of the foremost researchers, and I emphasize educators, about quantum computing. His model for teaching students, teaching freshmen about quantum computing, I believe is unparalleled anywhere else in the world. He's a fellow of the Japan Society of Applied Physics. And he is a founder of the IBM Q Network at Keio University. The IBM Q Network is 100 organizations, large companies, ExxonMobil, JP Morgan Chase, Delta, several hubs. First, and I would say today foremost, is Keio University under Professor Ito's leadership. They work with surrounding companies like Mitsubishi Chemical, MUFG, to bring quantum research home locally, regionally, as well as teach students. And he is our model, frankly, for how to do hubs and how to spread quantum out, both from a business development perspective as well as teaching. So with that, I think there is no better speaker to talk to us today about quantum computing, Professor Ito.
No? Okay. This one. Okay, for the interest of time, I think I'll talk to this microphone. So it's my great pleasure and also honor to be in this very, you know, well-established and conference, and I'm happy to introduce not the another person, but quantum computer. And my title today is Software Development for Quantum Computers Application in Financial and Chemical Engineering Sectors. And my talk will consist of the three parts. First, I'm going to introduce the basics of quantum computing. Then I will introduce our software development in the financial and chemical engineering sectors, as well as in the field of AI. And then, if time allows, I will talk about the results by Google so that you will understand the relation between Google and IBM's work. And they're very, very, basically very complementary. So I'm looking forward to speaking about all that. So I start from Moore's Law, and this contains the introduction of my sort of background. So basically, 1995, I received my PhD in material science, but also I was involved in the dark matter search. So I was in the physics field. I was building detector in the Center for Particle Astrophysics at UC Berkeley. And, you know, basically the detector I built is still looking for dark matter. It's been 30 years. I haven't heard back from my detector, so I hope he or she is doing well, but then I joined Keio University as a starting faculty position in 1995, and this is where I put question mark here, because for 2 years I look around to, you know, identify research topic that I should be working on. I didn't want to work on something that I can't do, but I wanted to work on something someone should be working, and it's worthwhile to attack for the next 20 years. And when I look at this Moore's Law plot, I realize that by 2030, in 20 years from now, a bit will be the size of the single atom. So back then, it was 1995, so it was, you know, 20, 35 years away, but I realized that, you know, this might be an interesting topic to work at for, you know, for the next 35 years, right? Processing information using single atom. And by definition, that is a quantum computer. So for a while, I looked around about the way to do this. And then this paper, by now known as a very classic paper by a person named Bruce Kane, came up. This was 1998. This is the year that the Google was established. And he proposed to perform calculation using single phosphorus atom embedded in the substrate of silicon semiconductor. So this was my starting point. Bruce, this author, spent a year in a University of New South Wales in Australia. He was there as a postdoc, and then he somehow came up with this idea. Bruce and I knew each other from UC Berkeley time, so I was very much impressed by his idea, and I immediately started to think about, you know, quantum computation using single atom or single electron in silicon. And I spent next 4 years after Bruce's announcement on learning quantum computing and also coming up with my own idea, which I succeeded in 2002, which I show in the right side panel. And this was a proposal paper I published, we published in Physical Review Letter in 2002. And that marked the beginning of my experimental work on quantum computing, experimental work towards realization of silicon quantum computer. I composed this, The World of Experimental Quantum Computation 2002, 18 years ago, to basically show different proposals, different ways of building quantum computing, computers. And the situation hasn't changed much in 18 years, as far as the level of what might be useful. Already, I listed superconducting qubits, which are shown on the right-hand side, right? And also, I listed spins and semiconductors and so on. But only a few survived so far to make the, you know, make basically survive up until now. In the case of silicon quantum computing, we started from theoretical work in 2002 all the way to 2011 for proof of concept experimental work we published in Nature 2011. This was also basically covered by New York Times. So this was actually quite well-known work. And then in 2015, in collaboration with University of New South Wales in Australia, we succeeded in building 2-qubit quantum computer using conventional silicon IC technologies. So, you know, we made real quantum computer, working quantum computer, using 2 electrons as qubits. And based on our work and also many other development, Intel in 2016, 4 years ago, announced the development of coming into the field of silicon quantum computer. And the following year, our team consisting of a researcher from New South Wales, University College London, KU University, and Simon Fraser University in Canada, we all got together at Intel in Oregon, and we celebrated our successful fabrication of two-qubit computer. And then we kind of decided to move apart, because after 2 qubits, it's going to be industry's job to integrate further. And I switched my interest to development of software and also algorithm for quantum computers, because, what is the use of quantum computer without softwares, without algorithms that are useful? And this is a big problem, of course, still today. We have to come up with something useful, something meaningful for academic as well as for industry, so that we provide meaning to the development of quantum computers. So this is something that I became very much interested in 2017. And that's the main reason that I decided to join the IBMQ network, and we established Hub at Keio University, which I will talk about later. So now I move on to basic introduction of the quantum computer. So quantum bit is different from classical bit. Classical bit, as I show here, uses state 0 or 1. There's nothing in between. Quantum computer, based on qubits, also use two digits, 0 and 1. But it allows for superposition of 0 and 1. So one bit can hold both 0 and 1 at the same time. I'll give you an idea. So here I show 0 at the lower state and 1 at the higher energy states. Think about compass. Compass pointing at north is lower energy state than compass pointing south. So that's the energy difference between pointing at south, north, and pointing at south. To turn the compass from north to south, it takes energy. That's the exact energy that requires to turn from 0 to 1. And interestingly, in the case of qubit, if you apply the exact energy you need to turn from 0 to 1, let's see what happened. Here I show on the right-hand side, time, as a function of time, we shine energy that needed to turn from 0 to 1, and how qubit behaves. Qubit starting from 0, turned as I keep shining energy, go up to 1, and doesn't stop there. It comes back to 0 again, and it goes back to 1 again, and so on. It oscillates between 0 and 1 as long as you keep shining this energy, keep providing this energy. This is called Rabi oscillation. This is a phenomena very unique to quantum, and this was given Nobel Prize in physics. So to turn from 0 to 1, it's a not gate operation. You shine energy, you provide energy, exact time from 0 to T1 prime shown here. So you have to tune the energy, but at the same time, to tune the time, so you turn exactly 0 to 1, okay? But you can also shine energy for the half of time to turn from 0 to 1 so that you put the spin, or you put the qubit sideways. And this side wave state is known as the superposition states of 0 and 1, 50% 0 and 50% 1. Then what happens if it's only quarter? This is 75% 0 and 25% 1. So you can just turn the weight percentage of the 0 and 1 continuously between 0 and 1 by tuning the time you provide energy. Now I'm going to put another second qubit, but now the phase is shifted. So now I have the red qubit as well as red qubit number 2 as well as blue original qubit number 1. And if I shine energy for T1 to blue qubit and T1 prime to red qubit, what happened? Blue qubit is turned sideways, as well as red qubit is turned sideways. They're both sideways, okay? But it's not static. I'm going to show you in the next slide, when blue and red are turned sideways, they don't stay, but they rotate. Okay? The rotation axis is very often defined by externally applied magnetic field. So they rotate. And here, as you can see, the blue is ahead of red. The rotation speed is the same. It's a called precession. But red, blue is always ahead of red. And this difference in what we call phase is also important quantum information. So it's not only zero and one, but also we have to control another parameter called phase. Let's say, okay, this is we call a coordinate at rest, but I'm not going to turn this into so-called rotational frame. Let's for imagine, okay, we are on Earth, and I think this direction is east. We are all rotating on Earth together. And I'm here, and Bob is there. Bob is ahead of me because Earth is turning this way. But we don't see each other moving because we are moving in the same speed, and we are observing each other from where I am, and Bob is observing from where he is. So he's rotating, but he's rotating from the static point of view. I'm not rotating. So this is, you know, how we view in the rotational frame. So from at the tip of this blue qubit, from this tip of blue qubit, red looks static, but red is just behind. And if you do this in this rotational frame, all of a sudden, the blue point becomes here, and red point becomes there. And then they are static. They're not moving because it's in rotational framework. This is called Bloch sphere. And any point on the sphere is the so-called pure state, pure quantum state, quantum information point. So basically, what I'm trying to say here is that quantum information takes continuous values between 0 and 1 and continuous value between phase 0 to 360 degrees. It's all continuous. It's not digital here. And we have to control such information. By the way, we have to cool down the quantum computer because the energy separation between 0 and 1 is very small. So we have to make the thermal energy smaller than the energy requires to turn 0 to 1. Okay? This is why quantum computer is cooled down nearly to 0 Kelvin. So once we accept such Bloch sphere picture, we can actually write down quantum information as a function of amplitude as well as phase. That's all you need to know, okay? This is the last equation I'm going to show. I just wanted to show you that quantum information, not about 0 and 1 only, but also we have to control phase. Now I can talk about superparallelism. With one bit, I can have both 0 and 1. With two bits, I can have 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1 at the same time. Four possibilities. With three bits shown here, I can have 0, 0, 0 all the way to 1, 1, 1. So I can have eight different combinations of numbers at the same time, okay? And for four bits, I can have 0, 0, 0, 0, 4, 0 to 1, 1, 1, 1, four ones. And that will be 2 to the 4, which is 16 combinations, 16 numbers. And if I have 280 qubits, that will be 2 to the 80 numbers carrying at the same time. That will be 10 to the 83. That's about equivalent to the number of atoms in the universe. So you can see quantum information, quantum computer can in parallel process so many numbers at the same time. That's really the power of quantum computer. Okay. I will show you the power using prime number factoring later. So what do we do using such qubits in quantum computing? Okay, in quantum computing, first we need to initialize all quantum bits. So set all qubits at zero. Then we need to operate, we need to perform operations. We need to run software depending on the, according to the algorithm. There are many kinds of operation. One is rotation, rotating one qubit from zero to one. But also there is such operation as changing the phase from zero phase to two pi and so on. Something that, that doesn't exist in a classical computing. There's another kind of operation that is called two-qubit gate. So depending on the condition state of one qubit, we do or we do not do anything to the other qubit. So in this case, we use interaction between two qubits, just like exclusive OR operation in the classical computing, okay? And those kind of combinations are sufficient to perform any quantum algorithm exists today. So combination of a single qubit and two qubit operations are so-called universal gates. And then at the end, we read out each qubit or qubits needed to be read out. And in this case, we just read out zero or one from each qubit. So here I show six qubit example. We only need to order what to do to six qubits. And at the end, I only need to read out, let's say if I need to read out six qubits, I only get strings of number 0000000, six zeros and six ones. Only one combination. So using quantum computer remotely or via cloud is very easy. Information I send through cloud is very small. And then suddenly the information becomes huge within quantum computer due to, you know, thanks to this quantum parallelism. But at the end, when we read out, we only get strings of just six, zero, or ones for this kind of quantum computing, okay? And what is the figure of merits? Of course, we need, you know, as many as large number of qubits as possible. But at the same time, quantum information is very vulnerable. We need to keep the amplitude, but at the same we need to keep the phase. So, you know, quantum information is very easily lost. So before we lose quantum information, we need to complete calculation. And those kind of all these figure of merits come into play. And IBM came up with very intelligent, very useful figure of merit called quantum volume. So we're going to use this as a quantum volume. This number quantum volume actually shows out, represents the advancement of the quantum computing, as I will show you in a momentarily. I said quantum information can be lost very easily. I showed quantum Bloch sphere to represent quantum information. Sometimes we lose amplitude, so amplitude zero becomes amplitude one. Sometimes we lose phase. The one that should be phase at that one point sometimes become the other direction by mistake. But the worst loss of information is so-called decoherence. So quantum information is represented by its sphere. But as time goes on, sometimes we lose the sphereness of the quantum information. And at the end, it becomes just one line pointing either zero or one. Right-hand side, zero or one is classical. Left-hand side, complete sphere is fully quantum. Something in between is something between quantum and classical. We want to have fully quantum all the time. And, you know, fully quantum computing is so-called fault-tolerant, error-corrected quantum computing. So the road ahead, this is the slide I retained from IBM. So I started off my talk from Moore's Law. Moore's Law started from number of transistors in the first four sort of years of the transistor developments. And then, of course, this doubling of the number of transistor continue until, let's say, today. The other one is quantum version of Moore's Law, shown right-hand side. In past 3 years, IBM has successfully advanced the quantum volume, doubling every year. And so this is, at least for now, called Gambetta's Law, after Jay Gambetta, who is responsible for leading the IBM Q research at IBM at site in the lab. And we're hoping that this will continue so that the algorithm we develop will be useful, let's say, in 7 or 10 years at a time. Based on this prediction, we develop our algorithm so that it will be useful, let's say, in 2030, as you will see. And today, IBM announced the achievement of quantum volume 32. So again, this Gambetta law is still going very strong, even this year. So there are many different kinds of quantum computers. At least from my point of view, true quantum computer is just one kind. It's called gate-based universal quantum computer, being developed by IBM, Google, Rigetti, Intel, IonQ, Microsoft, etc. There are other kinds of quantum computer. It's a subset of what we do because basically quantum computer shown left, gate-based is universal. So it can also perform the right-hand side, show the Ising machine shown on the right-hand side. The right-hand side shows quantum annealer being developed by D-Wave and NEC in Japan and so on. And more recently, Hitachi, Fujitsu, and Toshiba are using today's silicon chip to run quantum algorithm to show some speed up in calculation with respect to today's normal silicon chip, okay? But in reality, silicon chip Moore's Law is saturating. So even though today they show some speed up, from my point of view, real growth can only be achieved by true quantum devices. So this is why I'm very much interested, and this is why I'm working on IBM's universal quantum computer. Just to show how different the D-Wave machine or any quantum annealer is, I just want to give you how different the quantum annealing method is, okay? In quantum annealer, they also prepare qubits, as I show here. Here I show 5 by 5 qubits, so total of 25 qubits, prepared in a superposition of 0 and 1, sideways condition. And then what they do is they don't perform any gate operations to each qubit, but they introduce different interactions between neighboring qubits. So I show green some resistive kind of things between neighboring qubits. That shows the strength of the interaction. Sometimes strong interaction between two qubits mean two magnets see each magnetic field very strongly, whereas weak interaction shows very little magnetic field, you know, seeing each other, okay? And if they see magnetic field each other, if they are compass, they rotate themselves in a comfortable way, so they configure in some so-called quasi stable conditions, right? It's not the lowest energy, but the sub-level. But once you're stuck at sub-level, I can go in and turn one of the compass, and suddenly all the other compass, seeing this, my turning of this compass in the middle, the other compass turn and reconfigurate themselves so that they relax to different sort of, you know, metastable energy state. And the idea is to find the truly lowest energy states. And you can do this quantum mechanically by introducing tunneling from one state to the other by going through this barrier. Going through such barrier is possible quantum mechanically, but not classically. And going through this barrier only goes from higher energy states to lower energy states. Well, basically it goes horizontally, so it doesn't go up, but it goes horizontally to go to cascadingly going down to lower energy states. So this is the beauty of quantum mechanics. But as you can see, we're not performing any operation to individual qubit in this case. And programming exists in the way we design how we design the distribution of interaction between qubits. So that's just like this. This is just like map on our navigator. We provide map, and then the computer shows the shortest route from one place to another. Okay. So, how do we use the quantum parallelism in quantum algorithm? I show 15 equals to 3 times 5 as an example. Okay. There's a way that mathematicians came up to do this factoring. Mathematician says, okay, the number you're trying to factor is 15. So just come up with any number you want. Smaller than 15, actually smaller than half of 15. So I chose 2 randomly. And then I just perform the protocol that mathematician tells me. Okay, I chose 2, and mathematician tells me to do the 2 to the 0 divide by 15 and find the remainder. And remainder is 1. This is 2 to the 0 is 1, 1 divided by 15, remainder is 1. Then mathematician says, then do the 2 to the 1, 2 to the 2, 2 to the 3, 2 to the 4, 2 to the 5, and do the same. Just find remainders. And remainders turned out to be 1, 2, 4, 8, 1, 2, 4, 8. Here, we find periodicity, 4, in this sequence of the reminder. All I was looking for was this periodicity. Then once I see the periodicity, mathematician says, okay, now you know the periodicity. So just plug this periodicity, R, into these two equations. You know M. M is the number you randomly chosen, number two, and then do this, you know, calculation to find 5 and 3. Okay? This was quick because I, by luck, chose 2, which leads to this periodicity, 1, 4, in this kind of operation. If I choose 3, it doesn't lead to this sort of periodicity in remainder. If I choose 5, it doesn't bring me anywhere. If I choose 11, that will lead to periodicity 2, and I will successfully find factor 3 and 5. So, you know, this is very probabilistic, and this is no faster than the other method known today. But if you do it quantum mechanically, I can prepare 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, all these states all at once and do all these calculations in parallel, move from right to left, all in one step only, and find this periodicity 4. I don't have to try out 0 first. Then move on to 1 and move on to 2. I can try 0 all the way to whatever all at once. So this is super parallel calculation. And you know that we just prepared 0 and then do everything sideways to put 0 and 1 on each qubit, which means 0, 0, 0, 0 all the way to 1, 1, 1, and then use such state to go from 2 to the 0, 2 to the 1, all the way to finding reminder in just one step. So now I have this results, but I have to read this. I have to read this out, okay? I can only one combination of so many possibilities if I read out this point. I don't want to do that because I don't get this periodicity four. To do this, I'm going to do one more step of quantum computing, so-called quantum factoring. So basically, oh, somehow the figure is missing. So here, imagine I'm showing the wave, 0, 1, 2, 4, 0, 1, 2, 4. So this wave with a periodicity 4. And wave with a periodicity 4, I can, you know, Fourier transform to have just one peak at 4. Okay? One peak at 4 means first bit 0, bit number 0 is 0. Bit number 1 is 0. Bit number 2 is 0. Bit number 3 is 0. Then suddenly, bit number 4 is 1, and bit number 5 and the rest is 0. So I can have so many bits. I can have only bit 4, 1, the rest 0 at the end. And then if I read out each bit, I say number 0 bit is 0, and the only number 4 bit is 1, so that I know that periodicity must be 4, so that I can use today's computer to do the mathematical calculation to find out 3 and 5 as a result. So here I show this basics, I mean, very, very fundamental aspect of this quantum computing. I need to converge the results to something that is readable, so that among all the possible information, I can converge all this information into one bit so that I can find out the number I'm looking for, okay? So now I'm turned to development of quantum software application. There are so many software companies in the world. And we are not company, but we are collaborating, we are competing against, we're collaborating with and competing against such companies at KU University. So we have the IBM Q Network Hub at KU University shown at the left. We develop algorithms and softwares, and then we send our softwares via cloud to one of the 15 IBM Q quantum computers in Watson Research Center and also Poughkeepsie in New York. And then we receive results back from IBM. Okay, from the hub, whatever we do, IBM will not see what we do. If you use IBM Experience, IBM will see what kind of operations you're performing, but by contract, IBM will not actually peek into what we do. But of course, we work together with IBM in many algorithm developments, so of course IBM and KO work together. We've been working with IBM Q in the past 1.5 years. And we've been using, as I said, many quantum computers of IBM. And even if we use 20 qubit machines, we see differences in quantum volumes. So we start up from using an IBM Q Tokyo machine, and within 2 months or so, we see the emergence of IBM Q 20, same qubit, 20 qubit machine, but a better machine called Poughkeepsie. And again, in a month or two, we see emergence of even better computer called System 1. It's been an amazing experience. We can witness the advancement of quantum computing in real time. And now we have access to 53 qubit so-called Rochester devices. We at the hub many researchers and students gather, but also we have engineers stationing full-time from two banks, MUFG Mizuho, and two chemical companies, JSR and Mitsubishi Chemicals. Okay. So we have, as shown here, six faculty members of KO, applied mathematicians, quantum theorists, biochemical engineers, and so on working with us. And then those are the postdocs. Second rows are the postdocs working with us, applied mathematicians, computer scientists, chemical engineers, and so on, Monte Carlo simulators, so on. Third rows are the engineers coming from companies. And fourth rows is IBMers working full-time at KO University. So now I'm going to introduce our research. First one is the quantum finance teams, fast Monte Carlo calculation. We came up with this idea of so-called amplitude estimation. Mizuho, KO, MUFG, two banks, and IBM, we all published the same paper together. Two banks publishing the same together is something unheard of, and at least in Japan, okay? And basically, this is what we did. The company came up with this problem. Let's say bank received ¥1 million. That's too small. Okay, 100 million yen from the customer. And they have to transfer this money to the US, transfer the yen to dollar in next 24 hours. And to do this, they do Monte Carlo simulation for 5 to at least 10 hours to find out at which point from now the yen is strongest against dollar. But you know, they have to transfer money within 24 hours, but they lose first 5 or 10 hours doing this simulation. Okay? They don't want to do this. And so they wanted to join us to come up with faster way to perform Monte Carlo simulation. They also came up with this problem that they want to have as high accuracy as possible. Because today, even though their risk calculation shows that it is okay to put $100 million into this for a certain operation, because of the error associated with this Monte Carlo or other simulation that they use right now, they only put in $50 million instead of $100 million, just to be on the safe side. But if they know that accuracy of the calculation is good, then they can put in $100 million. So they want both speed and accuracy. Okay. And to do this, we came up with this idea that before we came up with this idea, in quantum calculation and a part of Monte Carlo, we do this sequential software running. We start from one software operation and then move on to next operation and next operation and so on, which takes time. But we came up with this idea to divide such long operation into many components that can be operated parallelly. So we use classical computer to distribute the data appropriately and then do all these quantum calculation in parallel. And then at the end, we suck out all these data from quantum computers to put them together appropriately using classical computer. So quantum computer doesn't work alone, but collaborate with today's computer to speed up the Monte Carlo simulation. So this, again, shows you the sort of idea. Here's the one spit out from quantum computer. This is a second spit out. Actually, they came up in parallel, so they all came up at the same time. And then if they put out all these information together using classical computer, we actually get one spike, which is the result which we were looking for, which is like the results of the Monte Carlo simulation. Okay? So by doing so, we actually were able to speed up the calculation, well, actually minimize the calculation in 5% of the time, so it's a great speed up. But at the same time, we have improved the error. So red is a quantum model, and green is the today's Monte Carlo, and the horizontal axis is the size of the calculation. For the big size calculation, we have smaller error for the quantum case. And we have been able to perform such calculation using real IBM Q devices. The green points are the results we obtained by IBM Experience, something that all of you can access. And cross points are the results we obtained from one of the 20 qubit machines. And the red curve is the theoretical value that we're trying to obtain. So as you can see, we're not there yet with today's 20 qubit machine. This is not the best 20 qubit machines. We have better 20 qubit machines. But as you can see, our 20 qubit machine is better than 5 qubit machine available to public. Okay, so this is the meaning of you joining the hub or IBM Q network, so you can access the useful IBM Q network machine. And this results were highly cited immediately by many groups. For example, QCWare is a startup company, and they adapted our method. Also, very well-known theoreticians called Scott Arison also referred to our paper and also adapted our method. And our method was also adopted by JP Morgan Chase to start a new collaboration between IBM and JP Morgan Chase. So development of such speed up and also improvement error, we think is going to be very helpful for the future of quantum finance and fintech in general. We are also working on basically breaking of the RSA cryptography, and we haven't succeeded yet. We haven't even been able to perform 15 equals 3 times 5, so you feel very safe. But soon we will be, as a white hacker, performing such operation, and then see by when you need to be very careful. So here I show you as a function of the quantum volume, here's the Gambetta law, and by, let's say, 2030, we think our algorithm will be useful, and some of them will be better than classical computing alone, so that it will influence the business significantly. I guess I'm running out of time, so I'm going to skip some of the results I have, but because I promised you, I just have to show quantum chemical engineering part. We work on basically battery research. This is the lithium dioxide air battery. This is the future of the battery, and we succeeded in exact modeling of the reaction associated with such batteries. So LiO2 goes from reactant to product. And again, we have been able to model this with only 2 qubits and using the Hamiltonian. And then we have been able to obtain initial states, transient state, and then final product of such molecule using real IBM Q quantum computers. So we came up with the results algorithm, and we came up with a software protocol that can be run by IBM Q, and we actually succeeded in such operations. So quantum computer is real, is in this sense real, and we are developing such algorithm. Lastly, very short AI. Again, there are this classification problem, finding the difference, differentiating between panda and gorilla. This is called support vector machine operation. And within this today's support vector machine operation, there's this inner product that takes long time with a classical computer. So IBM came up with this idea to replace only this part of calculation with the quantum computing, with this bracket notion. And this was the results of IBM alone in 2019. We extended this idea at Keio University together with IBM to actually make it runnable at IBM Q machine. So what we did is that, okay, only the kernel, only the inner product part is performed by quantum computer. The rest, the blue part, is all done by classical computer, NVIDIA GPUs and so on. But we have come up with a better way of preparing the data for quantum computation so that we can run this with the quantum computing. And as a result, theoretically, we achieve such benchmark testing, dividing, drawing divisions between orange and blue points, 99% accuracy. And if we run this with a real IBM Q computer, this was a result half a year ago, with the accuracy of 88% with a real IBM Q quantum computer. And this is improving with the improvement of the quantum volume. So again, AI using IBM Q is becoming real. And in the long run, we want to use such AI to develop new type of drugs and so on. So again, with the exponential growth of IBM Q, we hope to be able to apply AI and chemical engineering useful algorithm in 10 years or so. Okay, so maybe I should actually skip this Google part, but Google part, this was great results, and Google and IBM, they have very different concept. Google came up with this idea of showing at least one problem that on Earth that exists that can be outperformed by quantum computer compared with respect to today's supercomputing. IBM, they're not in rush, but they're steadily building programmable quantum computer for us. So in 10 years or so, algorithm we are developing will be very useful. Okay? So this is my last slide. We're having too much fun with quantum computing, and hopefully you'll join us. Anyone working in academia and also national labs and so on are welcome to come to Keio University for half a year to work with us. Industry, of course, we're open for any proposal of collaboration. So thank you so much.
I guess we actually dangerously running out of time. The next session starts actually in only a few minutes. I'd just like to remind you that there is a Birth of the Feather sessions on quantum computing this afternoon. So for those who would like to ask further questions, I would like to welcome you to go to that session. Otherwise, I would like to welcome everyone to go back to their sessions for this afternoon. Thank you.
1, 2, mic test.
1, 2, 1, 2. One, two, one, two.
Number 3.
Okay, everyone, we're going to start the so-called Birds of a Feather session, which really is just an opportunity to have a conversation, ask questions, things like that. So first of all, of course, you're welcome to sit 50 yards in front of me, but there's also a lot of seats up here. It's going to seem terribly formal, but there are microphones there, right, in the aisles and so forth. So if you have a general question,
okay.
Oh. So why don't we start? First of all, are there any questions, or what are your questions? Yes. Do you have a question? No.
Oh, that's gonna help.
Okay. Now it's on.
It's on. No, I'm just gonna tell everybody here that we have secret quantum T-shirts hidden in the room, and at the end of the session, as it closes down, we're going to hand them out to you. So we'll be back here.
So let me just start maybe a little bit by summarizing what we've done here yesterday and today. So yesterday we had a two-part workshop. Andrew Wack, my colleague at IBM, and I. Split it between my giving an overview of quantum computing, some of the high-level concepts, what's going on, a little bit of the status and milestones. Professor Ito introduced quantum volume today in his talk. I also spoke about that as well. And then after I spoke yesterday, Andrew got a little bit more down into the details of coding and Qiskit. So to summarize, and let me say from an educational perspective, what we were trying to tell you is that perhaps quantum computing is more advanced than you might have thought, though of course it is early days, right? I emphasize that nobody is doing breakthrough things that is significantly faster than what you can do with classical computers today. So if you are a very late adopter, go have a Mai Tai, right? I don't know, whatever. However, for education, it's really important because things are going to be happening very quickly in the 2020s, right? And there will be jobs. In fact, we have people called quantum software engineers. And those types of people will be in more demand as the decade goes on. Maybe not next year, maybe not the year after, but certainly as we go on. So while we are training people to do the theory, and we are training people to do the algorithms and so forth, this higher level development of how quantum will be used, and especially how it will be made to work in a complementary fashion with quantum computing, with classical computing, is very important. And so expect articles in 4 years saying there's a massive shortage of quantum software engineers. Okay? So someone needs to train them. Who might that be? We will do our part to a certain extent, but of course, that's otherwise. Quantum is essentially at this point when we talk about, and I just tend to abbreviate quantum as quantum. Quantum computing, while it works in a complementary fashion with classical computing, it is a whole industry, right? So the ecosystem we have to develop, the way we have to work with business, the way we have to educate people on just awareness of these things. So it's not like just a few people working in a lab and say, here's a nice little technology, I'll just stick it in and you'll never notice, right? So there's something for everyone in quantum, from a pure science perspective, from an engineering perspective, from a computer science perspective, from a mathematical perspective, from a business perspective. You highlighted some of the financial services applications, right? They're going to care about this. So what I'm really trying to say is that the quantum computing industry, and as it works throughout actual companies in industries, is going to be very broad, right? And almost no matter where you are starting, there's going to be something for you. All right. So let me turn it over to you for.
Okay. Oh, I have my mic.
Okay.
Okay.
So just any comments or. I'm talking ask a question, so you better ask
one,
a question.
Actually, first one is a lady.
So the if you could come to the mic just so other people can hear you.
Hi. I have a question about software developers. So you talked about the effect of quantum theory in software development, and I was reading some articles and I was talking with some software developers that increasingly new generations of software developers are different, and of course, because new generation of software development languages are more easier to write. So as a result, software developers that they emerge, you know, continuously, they are more into less theory and more into practice. This is just my broad question, that how do you think new generations of software developers are going to embrace this theoretical views, or what do you think is it going to be the same, or do you think the new generations might be different?
If I may start.
Okay, just, please.
Boy, it's fun to write new programming languages. Every time you come up with a new area, let's write a new language. Why not, right? Because that's so much fun. And after 6 months, you forgot why you were writing a new programming language, because it's really hard to write new programming languages after the first 2 days, right? And what's also true is that as you write new languages, you have to build up a whole developer community and ecosystem around that. So therefore, basically, your choice is, do you create a brand new language and try to get people to learn that, or do you somehow build off an existing language? Now, we are pretty far advanced today
terms of programming languages, very good ones. So we've got Swift, right? We've got Python, we've got Go, we've got Rust, we've got blah, blah, blah. Why would you possibly want to recreate an entire programming language just to do some quantum? Particularly when you can mix and match them via the library, the object structure. So at least that was our thinking with Qiskit, which is the open source software development. So Qiskit, which is how you actually write circuits, right, is written in Python for the most part. There's some underlying C code, as many of scientific software have. It does the handshaking with the quantum computers, right? And basically that does it for you. The Python does not affect your computational aspect because your hard work is on the quantum side, right? Versus a choice of C++ or something like this. So our decision, therefore, was let's use an existing tool chain, right? Let's use tools that people know and love. And this could be VS Code if you're doing it on the desktop. Increasingly, though, it's things like Jupyter Notebooks, right, which you can access through the cloud. It is things like Python. It is through standard libraries in Python. And for free, we get several hundred thousand Python developers who need this much more to do quantum instead of this much more to do a whole new language.
So Qiskit is great. This year and a half of working on Qiskit in the past at Keio University. Qiskit has been upgraded, I don't know, how many times Qiskit? I mean, so many times. I mean, seven times or eight times. And every time it was upgraded, it gave us a headache because it was better, but we also had to adapt ourselves for the new Qiskit. And sometimes something that was working with the old Qiskit didn't run on the new Qiskit and so on. But that's just a process of making things better. And it's been so exciting to see this early stage of development, and doing this early stage of development together with IBM, so that we know all sides of Qiskit now, because we've been working together with IBM. And it's been improved so much that now it's very sophisticated. But still, there are many rooms of the improvement. So I'm sure that Qiskit will be, will be upgraded in the future. Yeah.
Well, first off, I want to say your work is very exciting, and it's great to see people getting. I think it raises a lot of interesting quantum mechanics, which I find really a beneficial thing. I wanted to ask you a couple of questions. One is just to confirm my understanding, it sounds like the level of software development we're talking about is kind of like an equivalent to machine code or assembly code, that kind of thing, for qubits in that area, and you can elaborate on that. And then another question I have is that a long time ago, many, many years ago, I was involved in the nascent field of optical computing with nonlinear optics, and we all knew how exciting that felt and how amazing it was. And yet, it never really materialized. And so I'd want to know what you see as the distinction here. And then as a corollary to that, what specific types of computational problems or categories of problems are qubits going to solve? Much like optical computing could do a fast Fourier transform in one step, right? But what kind of categories of problems are more suited towards qubits than, say, our regular electronic ones and zeros? Because the other thing is, looking at it, optical computing got overtaken by better algorithms and faster compute times, and then it was irrelevant. And I'm just kind of wondering, there's this race going on. So who's going to win that arms race?
Do you want to go first?
So to the point about assembly language. In classical computing today, assembly language still exists. Down deep in the stack, there is assembly language. There is microcode in Z systems and things like this. And then there are several layers to the software stack. And when people produce brand new chips, they have some what I believe are very highly paid coders go in who can write optimized routines for those new chips, right? And then there are higher level languages, right? So there you get C, you get C++, and you work your way up the stack, and at some point you can abstract away most of what's going on through the compiler, and in fact you have optimizing compilers and so forth and things like that. Right now we have, I think, a little bit of all of that. And depending on who you are, you'll enter into the stack at different points. So the lowest level, and this is probably if you are a university researcher and you want microwave pulse control over the hardware, so below the gates, so below the ops, you want to design your own new ops, right? You can do that. Or you can come up a little bit higher and use some of the standard gates like the Hadamards and the Seagates and so forth. Or you can use what we used to call subroutines and things, which again have function, but it's the relatively low function, and then all the way up, at least in the case of Qiskit Aqua, you just have functions called search, and somehow magically it does what it does. So today, classically, it's certainly the case that the bulk of software developers live at the top part of the stack. In quantum, fewer people live at the top, more live in the middle, toward the bottom, but not quite all the way toward the bottom. But that changes, as you said, through every release of Qiskit.
So at our hub, I hired applied mathematicians, computer scientists, and theoretical quantum physicists. But I didn't hire experimental physicists like myself, because I knew that experimental physicists like myself would be probing the behavior of IBM Q system rather than trying to come up with, you know, a new algorithm. So that's the first thing I decided to do. I hire mathematicians and so on so that they all work together with the member company people, so that member company people come up with, bring in their problems, and we think about their problems together, but at the same time, solving their problems requires going to basics. So we start from math and, you know, coming up with new algorithms. We're trying to understand the problem with today's quantum algorithms and so on. So it's really true basic research. But at the end, we have to find a way to efficiently implement this and run this with the, you know, IBM Q real system. So this is what we do. And to do this, we don't need software engineers yet. We need more mathematicians and someone who's interested in writing code at this point. So that's where we are, yeah. And your last Thanks. Part, where we, I guess we'll come back to that later, your second question.
I think my question neatly fits to what you just said. I was especially excited to learn about your life, let's say, changing events when you turn from dark matter to, so to say, quantum computing on the physics side. And if I understood correctly, so you basically decided in 2015 then to a bit leave physics behind and
right.
turn to this software side.
Right.
And I was quite impressed by the applications you mentioned, and I wonder, so to say, what does it actually need to get into this field, to really turn away from the physics, and now
emergence of IBM Q, real quantum computer.
Yeah.
That was really the key, right?
Yeah. So what was the learning curve kind of, right? So when you, so to say, first working on semiconductors and quantum computers, and then really turn to applications. So, for example, is it tricky when you describe this support vector machine thing, right? Is it something that some computer scientist could understand the paper, so that was written?
Well, IBM came up with, you know, this kind of basic concept, and we could understand their paper. So, in this sense, you know, there were some foundations already sort of put forward before we came in. But what was really interesting was that the companies who decided to join us were very serious about, you know, doing this together. And they sent their people full-time at our campus. So that makes us, that made us serious too, right?
And they are the main experts.
Right, and they are the ones who know what kind of problem they will be facing in 10 years, for example, or 20 years. And then, you know, whatever the problem they bring in, you know, we can try to solve by quantum computer. I mean, they bring in so many problems, and only one or two or just a handful can be tackled right away. But still, with right kind of people, right team formation and everything, with the availability of the IBM Q and continuous, you know, advancement of the IBM Q in the past 1.5 years, you know, everything became very meaningful.
So let me answer a question you didn't quite ask, which is kind of like, how could you get involved, right? So there's one thing from a professional perspective, right? You know, you're a tenured faculty someplace and you want to move over here, you want to do this or whatever. But first of all, so Qiskit, which is this open source platform that we've developed and now have a community on, is open source. So the code's all available, right? So if you come from a computer science perspective, if you can code, you can look at how we do what we do, right? You can look at the implementation that we have of Deutsch's algorithm, right, of whatever. You can see what is there, right? You can contribute. So without making a major professional change of any sort, once you get to a point of competence, of knowing, you can become part of the community and contribute. And that may then give you more personal knowledge to say what you like doing, right? You might like more of the computer science versus the pulse level control, which is very low level, much closer to the hardware, much more physics, right, and things like that. The other point I wanted to make, which was, of all the different layers of the stack, and this is just for me personally, and thinking of software, it's the creation of new algorithms, which is going to be the hardest. And sometimes people comment, oh, you know, there are just 12 algorithms. Well, there are more than 12, and they're used in different ways and things like that. But nevertheless, you know, working from the use cases and mapping back to saying, what is your program of attack, right? Getting back to your question. This is not classical 4.0, right? You don't just say, I did it this way here, I'll change a few things, I'll do it that way. You don't load a classical piece of software on a quantum computer. You have to think very differently, right? So if there's one area that will hurt your head the most and will make you the most valuable, it's become really good at quantum algorithms and then helping to make those useful for people who are going to use them. That's just my personal opinion, but it seems to be, you know, they're rare. Let's put it this way. They're pretty rare.
Well, students are extremely excited. Whatever they do are new. But of course, you know, being new is not a sufficient condition, right? It has to be something meaningful as well to be sufficient. And, you know, we give them guidance. Many students come with this, you know, strong background in AI, for example. And, you know, they work, you know, with IBM Q, AI together and so on. So, you know, it's really interesting. Yeah. There's a question.
Okay. We'll go 1, 2.
Hi, thank you. So I have a slightly different kind of question. And I don't want your IBM-ness to hinder your thoughts here. So I'm curious about the kind of inherent difference between an annealing versus a pure quantum. And as we go up that software stack, in a sense, does this mean that from an algorithmic point of view, one can ignore the differences, or those differences inherent enough that we may risk having a Qiskit world and a not Qiskit world? Or are we at that beta VHS moment in time where we have to kind of pick a winner?
Okay, so annealing, annealer, they tackle the problem that can be modeled by so-called Ising model. So an Ising model is basically, you know, the model to optimize something, right? So first step to utilize annealer, you have to be able to model something within this framework of the Ising model. And then you just let it go. And then find the, you know, optimized results.
A different toolkit, or will that ultimately, those optimizing versus picking the factor, be all included? So Python has an extra couple of.
So okay, in the long run, basically annealing is a subset of the universal quantum computing.
Right.
So in this sense, and especially for annealing, one needs to be able to tweak the interaction between qubits. And that has been demonstrated very well by Google's method. And IBM's working on that. Once such, you know, switch on and off between qubit is established, one can also perform annealing using universal quantum computer.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I'll give you my personal, somewhat blunt opinion. Boy, I can go months without thinking about annealing, right? It's an odd situation because you have the one and only one quantum annealing company that's been around since 1999. They have never been able to prove that they can do anything significantly faster than classical optimization algorithms. It's a different way of doing it. Now, we all make choices if you're doing optimization. You know, there are different libraries. You can buy them. They're open source. Different techniques, right? So whatever works for you, if that's great, that's fine. Other kind of weirdness about it is, so D-Wave has their so-called quantum computers, their quantum effects, with virtually no entanglement going on, right? Which is means you're not really taking advantage of quantum mechanics in that way, right? You just have lots and lots of individual qubits, and then as was explored there. Now, what was interesting was they did what they did, and then Fujitsu did an FPGA-based solution, saying we don't actually need any of these qubit things. We'll just use FPGAs, and we'll be quantum-inspired. And then Microsoft borrowed that and said, you can do quantum-inspired, that is classical annealing algorithms on Azure. What does it have to do with quantum? Nothing, except the phrase quantum-inspired. And it's doing a classical technique with techniques borrowed from this, but it is pure classical computing. So annealing, in my personal opinion, is not the mainstream now or in the future. If it does good things for you and you like it, more power to you. But I would liken it, boy, you're going to get a really great annealing calculator versus you're going to get a universal gate-based quantum supercomputer. You want the calculator, go for it. Is that direct? Okay, excuse me.
Given that the gates are the building block of quantum algorithms, at least for IBM, is it possible that the design of new gates could lead to faster or more or new novel quantum algorithms rather than just working with the standard gates that IBM already has?
Yeah, go ahead. Go ahead.
Okay, so when we talk about gates, so classically, just to get some terminology, single bit, there's one single bit gate, which is just not. Turns a zero into a one and a one to zero. Then you have some two-bit gates, and you do ANDs and ORs, XORs, NANDs, so forth, things like this. And then you build up a whole lot of those, and you get addition, multiplication, and higher level operations, and you eventually have a supercomputer, right? So the gates are these things like ANDs and ORs and XORs, but the quantum versions of those.
And phase as well. Phase as well.
So we think of them as operations and things like this. Now, in the quantum world, there is a standard, let me say, pedagogical set of gates. And so there are X, Y, and Z rotation gates, where an X gate is somewhat similar classically to a knot gate. There's a Hadamard gate, there's a C knot, two qubit gate. On the classical side, it is in fact the case that if you have a single two qubit gate called a NAND, and a not AND gate, that's universal. You can create every other gate from that. You'd never want to because you'd have billions of gates, but you could. So there's a question of, can you create or start with a universal set of quantum gates and create any other possible gate, which is kind of what you're asking. And the answer is, so on two levels. So the answer is yes, pretty much, right? Close enough. But also, when we talk about even these, like a Hadamard gate, which is a great big capital H, down deep on our IBM Q computers, that's not implemented natively. It's a variety of a particular type of what we call a U-gate, right? And that is parameterized. There are three types of U-gates, one parameter, two parameter, three parameters, and then there's a C-naught, and then we can create anything we want from that. The purpose of having pulse level control is that you can design new primitive gates. And that's what we help people do. Now, the primitive gates will be different. So our primitive gates for superconducting are slightly different from Google's. We both do superconducting, are significantly different from ion trap, are significantly different from photonic optical computers, right? So everybody starts at some low set, and then you build up the usual set from there. But optimization is very important, which is why we put out pulse control. That said, very quickly, we think we'll stabilize on a pretty good set of gates. It's not forever research. It's a few years.
Oh, yeah. We're working on, you know, designing better gate as well.
Okay, because the reason I mention this is I'm a mathematician, but I don't know enough about this field to know what you can physically do. But I wrote a paper a few years ago where I used these discrete prime number clocks, and I showed that I can compute any Boolean function, and they can all operate in parallel if I have a physical device. But I don't know if I can. That's why I'm asking this.
We have what we believe are a good set of basic gates, and we're always working to improve them. And the core lowest level gates may change over time. But if you're coding, to kind of go back to your question about assembly language, you know, you'd really like to program up here, even if you're doing gates with the standard XYZ, H gate, C knots, you don't want to do these weird U things. And,
It's amazing how much freedom we are given by IBM. You know, I mean, you know, we can almost do whatever we want with their qubits. So in this sense, it's great.
I have a question, and it might be really a dumb one, but we have been talking about algorithms, but really to make this technology useful, let's assume that it's actually real data, let's say genomics data. So what are there particular data challenges, data structure issues, and so forth? So can you kind of enlighten us on that front?
You want to talk about IO thing?
Completely. In the sense that quantum processors today have no input output. How would you load these million bytes from disk into my quantum computer? There's no way of doing that, right? And the analogy here, just to give you an idea of where we are, and quantum computing is this weird mix of what seems like ancient technology and then cutting edge technology. If you look at some very old classical computers, you program them by flipping switches up and down. So up would be a one and down would be a zero. And you would program them in binary with switches. Well, the initial states or the early states of qubits are things that you would actually, you know, how you would put in your data. So right now you want to think of quantum processors for calculation. I did say this yesterday. If you ever read an article that says, oh, humans are creating petabytes of data a day, thank goodness we have quantum computers to process all this, the person absolutely does not know what he or she is talking about. Stop reading. Now, this probably will change. And one of the things we're going to need is something called quantum memory, or quantum RAM. That, to be able to do that, we're going to have to get further down the line to doing quantum error correction. Right? So use the computational qubits or a variety of those for storage, for at least longer storage. Right? And that's toward the tail end of the decade, probably.
So when we were setting up our hub at KU University, technicians start to worry about our infrastructure on network, thinking that we will be using such a large amount, we will be transferring such a large amount of data to IBM Watson Research Center. I said, old style modem will do our job because, you know, we just send very few data and suddenly this all these data becomes huge, transferring to huge Hilbert space within the IBM Q system. But once we read them up, they are very small again. So
so this is not a pure example, but just to give you an idea. So we cannot do anything better for the traveling salesman problem today. So just want to be very clear about that, okay? Yeah. However, it is a problem where with a relatively small amount of data, right, the cities, the distances among them, right, that problem just grows exponentially. So we're not looking for massive data-centric problems. We're looking for problems that somehow blow up in some way, either combinatorially, right, or in potential interactions in more of a physical sense. And that's the nature. Maybe eventually. Yeah, we'll see, but probably not this decade.
So I have two questions about some practical implications of quantum. The first would be, you said that we are at an early, probably very early time, but when and how should a company start investing in quantum computing? Especially where? In internal formation, if hiring new people? And then the second question is more about personal curiosity. Do you envision a future in which everyone has its quantum computer, or at least big companies have their own quantum computer? Or keeping the hardware operating correctly is too complicated, and then it will be always a cloud offered service?
We probably have the same opinion, but okay, I'll start from this. When companies should enter? Right now is the best time, just because we're working with few number of qubits, but when we start working with, let's say, 100 qubits, you have to be working with 2 to the 100 Hilbert space. And that's difficult to understand, difficult to imagine. But right now, you know, from 2 to 3 to 4 to 10 and 20, you know, we're witnessing all the developments and witness all these people working with us from company are achieving solid understanding of quantum computation. So they know what kind of problems are suited and what kind of problems are not suited for quantum computing. And they can refer to all these problems they have within their company so that, you know, they're bringing in right problems for us to work on right now so that, you know, we have this very stimulating environment. But, you know, I think this environment will be different in, let's say, 2 years. In 2 years, we'll be understanding everything, but those who are coming in 2 years, probably they will be working on based on something we develop, but their understanding is going to be different from what we have. So it's hard to predict, but what kind of problem we should tackle, it's good to understand the nature of quantum computing.
For the most part, we're thinking this will be cloud-based for the vast majority of people. Right? There are always special cases you could imagine. As Professor Ito announced, and so CES, what used to be called the Consumer Electronics Show, is going on in Las Vegas. So today, we, like many other companies, made announcements of some sort. One of the announcements was we had doubled this quantum volume, what we consider the processing power, in the over the last 10 months. I'm not sure you want to shell out a whole lot of millions of dollars if in 10 months there's going to be a machine that's twice as good, right? So therefore, you know, one, without paying a cent, you can use the IBM Q experience for the 5 and the 14 machines. If you'd like to join the IBM Q network, such as through the KO hub or some other way, there are other hubs, North Carolina State, and we have about 13 of them right now, that's possible. You can, with $0 invested, start learning about quantum and using real quantum computers. And that's what we recommend you do, right? And then, as to companies and so forth, that is frequently a question we get asked. So if a very large company comes in and we talk to them about quantum, basically a much more extended version with a lot more slides than what we're doing here, they ultimately say, who should we hire? Right? A lot of times we say things like physicists who can code, right? But that's starting to change. And as educational programs pick up. One other point I just want to make, since I'm in the neighborhood of education. I used to think that, boy, we need a lot more universities having full quantum computing classes. And that would be good. But you also need to start putting quantum computing into other classes. So there are three main parts of mathematics on which quantum computing depends, which is complex numbers, linear algebra, and probability. Each of those and all the different places you would teach them are great opportunities to talk a little bit of quantum. So if you're teaching a linear algebra class, do a lecture or two, right? Unitary matrices, spend a little bit more time on them, right? Those are key to quantum. Hermitian matrices, things like this, right? So you've got to start sneaking quantumness in across the board in terms of education. It doesn't have to just be one big class.
Hi, how you doing? Actually, just it's pretty close to what you were just talking about just now. When I teach students a couple of programming languages, let's say Java, Python, I've worked in software development for a good few years. And different programming languages often force people to think about problems in quite different ways. So the type of programming language you use, often you have to think in quite a different way depending on the programming language you're using. So solving something with Prolog or something is very different than solving it, let's say, with a procedural type language. I'm thinking now in terms of teaching. Right? So I know a lot of my students, they program away happily, let's say, in Java. And let's say they're blissfully unaware of multi-threading and multi-processing. And then when we cover that, suddenly they find this really difficult and they suddenly have to write multi-threaded code. And they find it quite tricky. I'm just wondering, sorry for the long question, a lot of the concepts behind quantum computing are quite tricky in terms of entanglement and superposition, etc. If a person wants to write an algorithm for a quantum computer, it's a two-part question, do they A, need to think about the solution in a very, very different way, in the same way that thinking about a solution for different programming languages requires a completely different. It's like if you cover objects in program, it is a completely different way of solving a problem. So do people have to learn to think in a completely different way? And then B, do people have to be very, very happy with, let's say, entanglement and superposition, et cetera, to the fundamental physics ideas involved to get them to think properly about the algorithms to run on quantum computers? That if you just give somebody a Python interface and say, look, just write 1 + 1 = 2 there and run it on the quantum computer, is that person then in danger really of making some really bad mistakes? So basically, do you really need to have a very good handle? And if you're teaching this stuff, do you really need students to understand all those basic fundamental quantum ideas to allow them to think in a way that they can write algorithms, proper algorithms, in quantum world?
Basically, okay, in short answer is, you don't necessarily need to know quantum mechanics to do the quantum computer programming. You need to know linear algebra and other mathematics, but also, you know, you have the big difference, as I said, is that there's a concept of phase. So it's not only zero and one, but also phase. So you have, you know, you have two freedom, parameters, phase and amplitude, just like, you know, wave mechanics. And then the rest is easy because you think mathematically, and mathematics doesn't lie. So if you're good in math, then students who are good in math just work on mathematics to come up with new idea. And then what kind of programming language you use, it doesn't matter but it does matter sometimes because very often we need to combine our quantum computing with current AI or other computers. We have to put them together. So the language must be compatible. Many of my students come in with a background in AI, not unfortunately necessarily in Watson, but they come in with Google's Python-based AI kind of a background. So very often they connect basically Google's AI to IBM quantum computer to work together and so on. So they need to know the universal sort of computer languages, but deep down on the basis, you just need to know the math. Yeah.
Rod Van Meter is a professor under you. He very happily tweeted that he had a class of freshmen. At the end of 1 hour, they were all doing some coding on a quantum computer. It's looking like students aren't having a whole lot of trouble picking this stuff up because they don't know well enough to be confused. They're not experienced enough to be confused. Okay? And that's sort of a way, because if you think, you know, this is the way a computer operates, I mean, your example of Prolog is very interesting because, yes, you know, it is different, but even in its time, functional programming was very different and distinct. In Python today, it's just like, yeah, it's just you do it, right? And things like this. But there are just many concepts. The concepts of randomness, right, are really extremely different. You don't run a quantum algorithm one time and expect to always get the right answer, right? There's a probabilistic analysis with it that says you will probably need to run it so many times to expect to see the correct answer, right? Well, that's okay, but that's part and parcel of what you do. So it's you learn it. But then there are some things. Just one of the algorithms that's always taught is Grover's algorithm, which is a wonderful pedagogical thing, but because we don't have a lot of data, it's in practice almost useless today. But it sounds good. If I give you 100 objects, distinct, unique objects, right, in random order, and I tell you, look for something, you know, the blue cube or something like this among these, it's going to take you at most 99 times. That is, you look at the first one, it's not that. You look at the second one, it's not that. By the time you get to the 99th, if that's not it, you assume it's the 100th, right? So that's slight refinement on the algorithm. But roughly, you know, 100 objects 100 times. The quantum algorithm says you can do that in about 10. 10, you know, I haven't described 10 watts. Turns out 10 calls to an oracle, right? So oracle-based computing, which is different from anything you typically learn in classical algorithms. But you learn it. And that is where a lot of advantage comes from, where quadratic advantage comes from. And that's something you have to wrap your head around. Right? But once you do, then you can see the value. Monte Carlo, if you ever teach Monte Carlo, it's a great place to learn more about, you know, quantum variations on that have quadratic improvements. So this is how you tend to squeeze it in.
So there are more than one measure of quality in computing, right? Speed has been king forever. But you probably know even today I can get the chips from different manufacturers, give the same data, the same algorithm, and I'm going to get a different answer depending on the precision I want. And so I wanted to ask and have you talk about, could you talk a little bit about precision when it comes to quantum computing and what it looks like today and maybe what the future? Because in my head, I can't quite scale it based on the number of qubits. Maybe you could do that for me.
Well, you can start.
Okay, so there's a traditional view, which if you are doing certain estimates with quantum algorithms, you need so many qubits to get so many decimal digits of accuracy. More qubits, you get more digits of accuracy. That's a fairly classical statement. With more bits, better algorithms should do better. But in this case, you know, this is typically how the algorithms are in quantum, right? So if you allow more bits, you can get it more accurately. So all I really want to say about that, that's not deep, if you will, right? The interesting thing is not so much precision, but how noise and errors come into this, right? So there's the numerical analysis, there can be all sorts of problems, but it's not noise that's caused by random quantum effects on your analog device, right? And so quantum volume encompasses many things, but a better quantum volume tells you that you've done a better job of controlling how well the gates do what you expect them to do, how well you are initializing the qubits, how accurately you're measuring the qubits, all these different things. And because these are physical devices, right, in a system, these are called physical qubits. In a textbook, those are what are called logical qubits. A logical qubit is perfect, it does exactly what you want to do, it lasts forever. Physical qubits have coherence times, they have noise. We will eventually be able to build logical qubits from a whole lot of physical qubits. So it's kind of two sides. There's the algorithmic analysis view of precision, that's usually included in the algorithms, but the other part, which is more of an issue right now, is how are errors screwing up your calculation?
So I'll give you the user's point of view. So when we work with 20-qubit machine, we never make full use of 20 qubits. We choose the best 2 or 3 or 4 qubits within the 20 for our application. And if we manage to choose the best 4, for example, then with the periodic calibration that IBM performed and so on, the results are very consistent, reproducible. So, but you know, just like if you have 300, you know, the car that goes up to 200 miles per hour, you'd never drive always with the 200 miles per hour. We always work with best qubits right now we have within the 20-qubit machine. And then we get very good, I mean, you know, it's not perfect, but it's almost, you know, perfect, reproducible, meaningful results. But of course, it's better to have perfect qubits in the future. And we think that if we have 100 perfect qubits, and with the way we accelerate our algorithm, you know, development, with 100 perfect qubits, we think there will be applications that can be very useful in industry. That's my guess.
By the way, four bits classically. What can you do with 4 bits? It's half a byte. Doesn't sound like very exciting. 4 qubits is a 2^4 or 16-dimensional complex vector space. Okay. Yes.
So I had a question on integration, which kind of comes back to what we had before about the access model through the cloud, which of course is very nice, gives a lot of people access now and makes it easy to work with it. But given the fact that quantum computing relies on classical computing, basically turns it into a sophisticated accelerator, do you see there as some kind of way to integrate it closer? Does it benefit? In particular at the high end, if I have an exascale facility and I put a quantum computer on the floor as well, should I really put them next to each other or should I connect them? And what does it mean for programming them?
Yes, I see. Go ahead.
Classical plus
quantum, well, the classical plus quantum, as I've already shown you, you know, there are two ways, as Bob explained yesterday. One is to do what we can and replace part of the classical problem, a part of the classical problem with the quantum computer so that we can get the speed up. Intel clearly states that this is one way to continue with advancement predicted by Moore's law. So Intel's talking about overall sort of, you know, continuing with Moore's law by getting help by quantum computer and other new ways to keep improving the, you know, keep getting the, you know, advancement in the computational power predicted by Moore's law. But at the same time, we're always looking for so-called quantum leap, something that can actually step with a step function we can actually outperform today's computing. So we're always looking for it, but it's difficult for me to imagine that something unachievable by today's computer can be achieved by standalone quantum computer only.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's exactly right.
Yeah.
So we, unfortunately, we shorthand, when we say quantum computing, we mean classical systems working with quantum computers. We do not mean purely only what is running on a quantum computer. I do not need, and probably will never need, a quantum computer to run the interface for my phone, right? In the same way that GPUs are good in some cases, you know, maybe you can get away without them. But the idea with quantum computers is that they will help you solve what are considered intractable problems today. We are, to answer your question another way, so for us, we are in terms of IBM, we are in our fourth year of having quantum computers out there. And every year, I more or less have a theme in my head, which is more or less shared with everybody else. Everybody has certain things. So this last year, for example, I had two themes. One were industry solutions, industry use cases, as well as the software development stack, right? This year, one of them is how the heck does a quantum computer work with an HPC system? How do you integrate them? Because that's where you're going to look for the problems. If your HPC system can't do it, right, it's probably in that neighborhood that you're going to want to use a quantum computer. Right? Yeah.
So cloud computing is the way to go, I think. And there will be the time in the future that we just order some, you know, send out our job, and you don't even notice which part of this job is being performed by quantum computers. You just achieve overall improvement and speed up and so on, accuracy in total computing, I think. Also, for us, it is good not to have computer in our campus, because I think we are not ready for sophisticated attack by cyber attack at the university level. You know, if you have quantum computer on campus, you never know what's going to happen. You may get this, you know, sort of, you know, high level attack by, I don't know, someone, which is difficult to manage at the university level. But you know, having this at IBM really relieve us from such kind of a concern. So, and also we have the access to the best quantum computer all the time. You know, they improve their computers, and then we always have the access to their best computers as well as, you know, those computers that are, you know, that are not the best, not the latest, but, you know, the ones that we're very familiar in working with. So So we have, we're in a very good position for this. Yeah.
Thanks. Two questions. First, how does the limited connectivity of the qubits, like that you cannot entangle each and every one, how does that affect the computational performance of the chip? I guess it's in any case a problem of programmability when you have those limitations. And the other is, do you also consider more than two state systems like QDITs, which have more than binary computational capabilities?
I couldn't hear the first part.
I knew it till you asked me.
First part, I couldn't hear.
What was the first part? The limited. Limited connectivity.
Limited.
So I'll kind of start answering. Okay. So let's say I have. So our largest device is 53 qubits. Now, to do an operation between two qubits, those have to be somehow physically connected. Somehow. Because if one lives over here and it's no way related to this one, I can't do anything with both of them. So, therefore, if you look at the map, and you showed several what we call connection or coupling maps, some of the qubits are hardwired. There is, if you look at the chip, there's an actual connection between them. And so that means that in one shot, you can frequently do a two-qubit operation. They're right next to each other. You can talk to two of them right pretty much at the same time and do what you need to do. If they are separated, you can't do it in one shot. You have to have additional operations. So you increase the depth of your circuit by entangling more qubits that are farther away, but it is still possible. Now, there are trade-offs. So when I was talking about annealing before, right? If you have no connections, so let's consider the extremes. Zero connections. If I have zero connections, I can do no entanglement. It's not a quantum computer worth speaking about. So we don't want zero. If you connected every single qubit to every single qubit, that just gets untenable very, very quickly as you get more and more qubits, right? There are some technologies like ion trap that claim to be able to do that more easily, but certainly in things we are doing in silicon and analog based, you just can't do that. So this means that zero is bad and all of them are just not reasonable to do. You have to have some number in the middle. But it's not just a random number. There is a layout to where those qubits live. And so what you're trying to do is you are trying to, you put the computers, think of them as an array, just to simplify, right? And some of them have connections, but not all of them, right? One is you'd like a nice repeatable pattern. Because as we add more and more qubits, you'd like to think of tiling. You have this block of qubits, we put this block of qubits, we put this block of qubits. It makes it very nice to kind of understand to replicate in blocks. So that's a good thing. When two qubits are connected, there's a much greater chance of crosstalk. I'm talking to you, but I'm speaking a little too loudly, and I'm affecting you over here, because there's a physical connection, right? If there's no physical connection, you can't hear me very well, right? So there are cons. There are negatives to being physically connected. So you want to decrease that sort of crosstalk. The layouts that we're looking at now, also we're thinking of implementing future error correction on the chips, right? And so those have to be configured in a certain way. They have to have certain error rates, so forth and things like that. So what we have run for every generation of chips is thousands upon thousands of simulations to try to come up with good repetitive tiling patterns that allow us to be able to talk to that many qubits. We speak to them all around 5 gigahertz microwave range, just slight variations. You can only move so far. It's okay if I talk to this qubit the same one as that one, but I can't talk to two of them close to each other at very close, right? So they're all these ridiculous factors. So that's a long answer, and the thing is, you know, it's less trivial than you may think. So you simulate and figure out where you're going.
But that's a very good answer, thanks for that. But when you're talking about 218 qubits giving you the capability of states to have 10 to the 81 states,
No, because I can fully entangle a machine if I have enough depth. Right?
Once they are connected, you can disconnect them and still they are entangled. So
you have to do it one by one.
That's right. And it's also the case that you are not going around constantly entangling all the qubits. You're entangling certain qubits.
Everywhere. You can do everywhere. Right.
It's right. Usually just an interesting test to see if you can entangle them all. One way to think about entanglement, kind of a simplified way, in three dimensions, and this is really a grossly simplified way, if I did not have entanglement, in three dimensions, I could have points on the axes. They live on the axes, but I couldn't have any that live off the axes. Right? So the interesting ones that live off the axes, if you will, are the entangled ones. So we can't fill up the space. We have much lower dimensional use of it, right, without entanglement. And so, again, this is speaking very roughly and coarsely, but it gives you an idea that we're not taking full advantage of this 2 to the nth size space if we can't do entanglement when we want to do entanglement.
Also, there are physicists working on multi-state qubits. Develop at the basic research level, people are trying to develop a it's not qubit, but you know, 4 states within one quantum so that they can have 0001, 1011, and so on. That was your second question. But it's very difficult to stabilize all of these states in equally. So it's, right now, it's better to use with qubit, which only has 2 states, 0 and 1.
Yeah, it's hard to tell them apart.
Right,
is a thing.
Right.
And the superconducting technology we use is Josephson junctions. So there's enough of a nonlinear difference between them that we can say, that's a 0 and that's a 1.
Right.
If it was just linear, 0, 1, 2, 3, in practice you couldn't tell the difference. It would have to be 0, 1.
Yeah, it's an academic interest.
In your talk, you said that the phase were continuous values
you
could take on. So my question is, let's say I subdivide the circle, thinking that as phase, into 100 pieces, to what extent can I set, how many qubits can I set at each? I've subdivided the circle evenly, 100 different phases. So to what extent can I set the qubits at those at different?
I mean, theoretically, you can just, it's continuous, so you can just do whatever you want, right?
And you can, and the only limitation is physically how you entangle them?
Right.
Interesting. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So.
Yeah, I mean, it's any point on sphere is a. So this is our goal. So we want to come up with the shape, as Bob said, the way to control the quantum bit by pulse shaping and so on, to control the position of the qubit as precisely as possible. Once we obtain such, that's a perfect qubit, perfect operation, and so on. That's really the goal of developing the quantum computer. But that's, there's no physical law that then.
No.
Right.
It's only the engineering.
Right. It's really the engineering.
So, 'cause I'm thinking,
it's really the engineering. There's no physical law to limit us.
By the way, this word phase, So I was trained as a mathematician.
Right.
And I took complex analysis.
Okay, okay.
And I went back and I looked for this word, okay. Phase,
yeah.
In my good old complex analysis book. Yeah. Never mentioned.
Okay, so that's a problem with the,
physics term,
yeah.
It's what, you know, it relates to when you're talking about polar notation, right? It's right. That angle, you know, for a single complex number, which is called the arg, not the phase.
It's the arg, yeah. Right.
So it's called the arg in mathematics, not the phase. So the point being is that, you know, aside from everything else we've talked about the state of the technology, we're at this phase where we have a little physics terminology, right? We have a little computer science terminology. Andrew pointed out yesterday, you know, which is the most significant bit or qubit, which is the least significant. People have been arguing about that. It is my fervent hope that in 10 years, you know,
interesting.
A lot of the physics stuff, you know, like interference is
right.
Another one.
Right.
You know, waves interfering. In math, we call it canceling out, right? You know, but it has a very fancy interpretation, and so this. Yeah, so it helps if you have both angles, and particularly with algorithms, right? When thinking about that.
Well, that's interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah. Topology, we only start to use recently with the topological. Qubit and topological, you know, insulator, topological metal, and so on in the physics world.
Yeah,
right.
There are several. Also, the connection map of the device, which we talked about, is somewhat topological.
Yeah, I guess I want to go kind of back to applications. So you mentioned batteries in your presentation, and I just noticed that there was an announcement recently of Daimler. An IBM collaboration. So can you give us any vision in terms of how this will be changing the battery technology implications for you know, transportation, for example, in the future?
Well, to be honest, we're trying to find out. But this research itself is very interesting because we're right now starting to find out that using real quantum computer, we can actually simulate the behavior of the molecule, like its energy level of the molecule. You, for example, using only 2 qubits, and that is a huge advancement compared to, you know, using today's one of the best computers to model the same molecule. So, you know, things can be simplify in a rigorous way with a quantum computer, because after all, behavior of the molecule is based on quantum mechanics. So in this sense, it's very exciting, and we're yet to find out what exact direction we should be heading to develop new batteries or so on. But the fact that we can actually model lithium dioxide, you know, starting point to reactants and so on, that itself is exciting, and you know we've achieved this within only 1 year, so. Yeah.
Turns out, luckily,
yeah, there's
lithium is a very small atom.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. And the molecules are also very small, which means that they will be attackable much sooner.
Yeah, I'm also curious that. In some way, to almost think that those of us that came out of analog computing 50 years ago, if in fact, if we understand for the battery case or for the chemical structures, that is quantum to begin with, it seems like it's a more natural impedance match between able to use the qubits to be able to model certain of those properties in other types of problems. And I'm kind of wondering, have you played with that very much? I mean, because it just seems like it's so natural to almost have a cycling back 50, 80 years to realize, no, you know, the world is computing.
Yeah.
And it's computing through these techniques. You know, how do we actually capture some of that intuition in the way we do the design patterns for what you're talking about?
So I guess it's a comment?
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, I agree. And that's, you know, Feynman's comment in 1981, which was, you know, nature isn't classical, damn it, right? It's built on quantum mechanics. And so therefore you need a computing system that's built on the same structure, right? The same model to try to make progress.
Today and yesterday, we were looking at the Shor algorithm, and there's an interesting sense that I was turning on a certain notion of Fourier analysis.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But that Fourier analysis is there for deeper reasons.
That's right.
Thank you for understanding this correctly. Yeah.
Thank you. If I'm interested to dive in quantum computing and quantum programming, is there any kind of hello world you can recommend me to start with?
You mean how to learn?
Like if you learn a programming language or a new IT technology, there's always something called hello world. So a pretty basic program with which you start to, you know what I mean?
Yeah. So it's kind of, is there a hello world? Okay, so first of all, there's no concept of string, there's no concept of I/O, so there's no concept of printing. So you can't say print hello world. So you have to think of something else. Right? Typically, at least for me, I think the most interesting hello world ones are when you start just simply using Hadamard gates. And so a single Hadamard appears to be fairly random. So you start with zero, you start with one, you apply a Hadamard, you measure, you get zero, one, nothing. 50-50, perfectly, right? However, if before you measure it, right, you do another Hadamard, magically it seemingly undoes that randomness. If you start with a zero, you end up with a zero. So how did quantum, right, you would think, make things completely random and then go backwards completely and unrandomize? Well, the fact is it never was completely random in the middle. And so the idea is that, frankly, you're not allowed to peek, right? This is one of the things. Peeking is measuring. So you can't go into the middle of a quantum circuit and say, I just want to check what the values are right now. That destroys the entire computation. That does not happen classically. So understanding that and that alone, you know, as we were talking before about what's different, right? It's the most basic thing, I think, that shows you difference from classical behavior. Have we quantumed you out? Okay, so just as we kind of get toward the end here, we are very pleased with certain number of people who came to the keynote and who hung around here. We'd love to be able to get a larger track on quantum next year. Certainly there's technology, but boy, the teaching aspect is so, so important to this. We need people how to do this, think about how to teach this. There are a lot of books that have been out for a long time, but frankly, a lot of them just teach it the same old way. They've always been teaching it. They're just variations. We need fresh ideas of how to introduce this to students, and then as we're thinking about use cases. So just as you go off and you talk to other people, right, and you think about Hicks next year, right, we're going to try to put in some extra effort over the next couple of months to build up a much bigger program in which you don't just attend, but you actively participate and lead and all these types of things.
So I will be teaching juniors in science and engineering this year. And my courses will be filmed. And it's going to be made available to everyone on the KU University YouTube channel. And so, and with the help of IBM as well. So there will be hands-on exercises as well. So it's going to be the combination of basics as in lecture room as well as exercising using a real quantum computer. So maybe I can introduce this in the future. Yeah, so
that's a great idea. Okay. And just one final plug, if I may, and I know this is IBM-ish, okay. Which is, but simply, there are very nice quantum computers and simulators available at no charge to the IBM Q Experience. QuizKit is available. In terms of teaching, I was thinking of this when you were speaking before. Start using Jupyter Notebooks. Okay? People are going to need them for AI. They're using them for AI. They're going to use them for quantum. You're not just going to sit in a code editor, you know, for a lot of things anymore. And in fact, they're an active way of doing teaching. So. So Susskind's book, Quantum Mechanics, The Theoretical Minimum. But remember, you don't need to learn quantum mechanics to learn quantum computing. You can start by learning quantum computing, and then as necessary, right? I mean, I can describe entanglement and superposition to you using no physics whatsoever, just basic math, right? If you want to know where they came from, if you want to know, you know, what we're talking about two photons that are entangled, well, that's interesting. Right, but then you branch off. So you don't have to understand infinite dimensional complex Hilbert spaces, right, to work with two qubits. Okay, so don't be scared, just jump in.
Okay.
Thank you.
Guitars are playing, the guitars are playing.